morning, church. I greet and welcome you all in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for this morning worship service. As we have come to worship God, let us quieten our hearts and minds. Let us prepare ourselves to worship our living God by spending few moments in silence. Let us spend few moments in silence. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practice kindness, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, says the Lord. Let us worship God together. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this morning. Thank you for this beautiful day that you have blessed us with. Thank you for your wonderful mercies that has sustained us. Thank you for enabling us to see this day as we, your people, have gathered here to worship you. Lord, we pray that be present amidst of us. Fill us with thy Holy Spirit and help us to worship you in truth and in spirit, O Master. Lord, as we sing songs to your name, as we worship you, as we meditate upon your word, as we offer offerings and ourselves, we pray that Heavenly Father be present amidst of us. May your name be lifted high and may your name be glorified in and through all these acts of worship. Bless each and every component of this worship, O Master. Help us to love you with all our hearts, with all our minds, with all our souls, and with all our strengths, O Master. Help us to always look up to you for everything, O Master. As we have gathered here, we seek your blessings, O Master. You be the Alpha and the Omega of this service, the beginning and the end, and you receive all glory, honor, and praise, and bless us through this service. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us all sing hymn number 26, hymn number 26, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. As we sing this hymn, let us sing and glorify God.
Cherubim and Seraphim and out and evermore shall be. Holy, 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 though the darkness hide thee, though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see. Thou art holy, there is none beside thee, perfect in power, love and purity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
As we continue to be in the Lord's presence, let us unite in this historic confession of Christian faith. Let us recite the Apostles' Creed together. The Apostles' Creed. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Dear people of God, it is appropriate and rightful duty for each one of us to worship our living God and to thank him for all the wonderful things that he has done in our lives. He had been a gracious and compassionate God. He has led us thus far, feeding us, protecting us, and giving all our heart's desire. In response to all the wonderful deeds that he has done to us, let us come with our hearts of thanksgiving. Let us worship God, as Psalmist says in Psalms 100, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his people and sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generation. Let us worship God as the worship team comes forward and leads us in the time of singing and praise. Let us join together and let us worship our living God.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, church. It's wonderful to be back in the Lord's presence, to be worshiping with all of you through this online worship service. God has given us a lot of reasons to be thankful about, a lot of reasons to worship him for. He has kept us safe and sound amidst all this chaos around us. He has given us opportunities to meet through these online worship services and through web conferences for all our services, and He has enabled us to keep in touch through these last 2 to 3 months. Our dear pastor, Reverend Alfred, has also completed 1 year with us this month. So there's a lot to worship God for. So let us sing the first song as we begin this worship session. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, just the sheep of His hand. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand, just the sheep of His hand. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. Once again, church. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand, just the sheep of His hand, and the sheep of His hand, just the sheep of His hand. Hallelujah. We are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand. We are here to worship Him. That's right, church. God has given us this beautiful privilege of being able to worship Him wherever we are. Let us make use of this. Let us lift His name up on high. The next song we're going to sing is, Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing Your praises. Hallelujah. I'm sure all of you know this song. So wherever we are, sitting, standing, or in our beds, let us just raise our voices and sing the song. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing Your praises. I'm so glad You're in my life. I'm so glad You came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift Your name on high. Let's sing this again. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing Your praises. I'm so glad You're in my life. I'm so glad You came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, we lift your name on high this morning, O Master. We are here to worship you. We are here to sing your praises. We love to sing your praises, O Master. Church, let us sing this chorus one more time with full zest. Lord, I lift you. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Hallelujah. Let us worship him, church. Let us continue to open our mouths and just worship our Lord. He is beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us sing this next song, church.
Ooh.
world praises you, I stand in awe of you. Let us sing this once again. I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, from whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. Yes, Lord, we stand here in your midst, O Master, surrendering ourselves. We stand in awe of your majesty, O Master. You are enthroned above, and you control all of our lives, O Master. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us sing this chorus once again, church. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words. Hallelujah. You are beautiful beyond description, too marvelous for words, too wonderful for comprehension, like nothing ever seen or heard. Who can match your infinite wisdom? Who can fathom the depths of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above. I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. Let us all sing this for one last time. I stand in awe of you. I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. Holy God, to whom all praise is due, I stand in awe of you. Hallelujah. Yes, O Master, we stand in absolute awe of everything that you've done for us, O Master, for everything that you continue to bestow upon us, for all the blessings that you've showered upon us, Lord. As we are gathered here, wherever we are, we stand in your presence, O Master. We surrender ourselves to your will. You take control of our lives. You lead us going forward. Hallelujah, hallelujah. As we proceed with the worship service this morning, O Master, we commit each and every one of us into your mighty hands. We commit our pastor, who will bring us your word unto us, into your mighty hands. Please speak to us through him. Edify our souls and exhort us, O Master. Once again, each and every one of us, I commit into your hands. In Jesus' mighty and matchless name I pray. Amen.
Dear people of God, as we continue to be in the Lord's presence, let us come before his throne of grace, thanking him for all the things that he has done. Let us come before his throne and pour out our hearts. Let us seek God's intervention, God's hand upon our lives. As Matthew chapter 7 verses 7 says, ask and it shall be given, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened unto you. As we are weak, as we are fragile, the only hope and strength that we can get from is from our Lord. David received his strength from the God Almighty. As he writes in Psalms, I lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence my help comes from. My help comes from the Lord, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Yes, dear people of God, let us come and find strength in God's presence. Let us come in prayer in God's presence to find strength for our lives. Let us pray. Let us pray. Almighty God, who has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give you thanks for all the creation, hear us, O Lord, when we pray, that it may please you to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. Help us, O Lord, to confess your holy name and bear witness to all the things that you do to us, O Master. Help us to bear witness with courage and fidelity. At this moment, O Lord, as we, your creation, come to your throne of grace, we acknowledge that you are a creator. Thank you for creating us in our mother's womb and bringing us to this world and sustaining us thus far, O Lord. Thank you for your grace and your mercies that has been abundant in our lives, O Master. Thank you for knowing our names. Thank you for knowing our thoughts, O Master. Thank you for your hand that has been always with us, O Lord. At this moment, O Lord, as we, your creation, we confess and we proclaim your word to people around us, that you are a God, you are a master, you are a shepherd, you are a king. Thank you, Master, for being a King of kings and Lord of lords. Thank you for being a shepherd and leading us thus far, O Master. Thank you for your righteousness. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for all that you have done in our lives, O Master. Thank you for this gift of life. It is purely by your grace and your mercies that we are alive today. Thank you for adding new day into our lives, O Master. Thank you for your wonderful gift of life. As we, your people, as we have come into your throne of grace, we acknowledge that, O Lord, it is purely by your grace and your mercies that you have enabled us to see this day. Give us your joy, your peace, and prosperity, O Lord. Help us to always rejoice in you and be grateful to you for all the blessings, O Master. At this moment, O Lord, we thank you for the space where we can come together as a church, as individuals, to pour out our hearts, to seek your blessings upon our lives, O Lord. Thank you for our families. Thank you for each and every member of our families, O Lord. Thank you for this divine space where we can grow together in your love and serve you, O Master. Bless each and every member of our family, O Lord. Help us to always be grateful to you for abundant blessings in our lives, O Lord. As Joshua confessed, I and my family will serve the Lord. Help us to also to serve you as a family, O Lord. Protect our families from all the dangers, from all the diseases, satanic temptations, and evil eyes, O Lord. Put your edge around us through the fire of Holy Spirit. Lord, may we rejoice in your good works and glorify your name as a family, O Lord. Thank you for this spiritual family, Sarjapur Road Methodist Church. Thank you for this divine space where we can come together in fellowship, love each other, love you, and worship you, O Master. as we come together, O Lord. Bless each one of us as church members. Help us to rejoice in your wonderful deeds, O Master. Help us to always love our fellow beings. Do good works for your glory, O Master. As we meditate your word, as we engage in each other's life, may your name be glorified in and through us, O Master. As we are seeking for a place, we pray that Heavenly Father make all the crooked paths straight and show us the place where we can worship you in truth and in spirit, O Master. Give us all the resources, O Lord. Speak to each and every person who is in charge of this, O Master. Encourage them, inspire them, O Lord, to find a place and to build your church, O Master, Lord. Give us your grace and your mercies. Show us, reveal your plans and purpose for Sarjapur Road Methodist Church, O Master. At this moment, O Lord, we come to your throne of grace as sinners, and we confess all our sins. Yes, O Lord, we have committed sin against you. We are vilest offenders. We have sinned against you and our fellow beings, O Master. At this moment, we seek your forgiveness. As David prayed, we too pray, O Lord, have mercy on us. According to your steadfast love and according to your abundant mercies, blot out all our transgressions. Wash our sins thoroughly through the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and make us holy and worthy to be your sons and daughters, O Lord. Create in us a clean heart. If anything is there in us which is evil in your sight, at this moment we pray that Heavenly Father, remove everything, remove every evil thought, evil actions, O Master, evil intentions. Help us to always have a right attitude, right spirit and right mind, O Master, which is pleasing and which is according to your will, plan and purpose. At this moment, O Lord, we come to your throne of grace, humbling ourselves and praying for our church, all the wings of the church. We especially remember our Sunday school children. Thank you for giving us this beautiful children, O Master. Bless each one of them. As you welcome them, we too welcome them into your presence, O Master, Lord. Unless we become like them, we will not enter kingdom of God. Yes, O Lord, thank you for teaching life's lesson through children, O Master. Help us to be humble, innocent, accepting and loving like children, O Master. Help us as parents and teachers, as church, to nurture them in your love. Help them to grow in your word, O Master Lord. Help them to mold and shape their lives according to your plans that you have set for them. Reveal your plans to the parents and to the Sunday school teachers, O Master. Work in their hearts and prepare them to receive you as their personal savior in their lives. We especially thank you for all the teachers, their commitment, their sacrifice, and their lives, O Master, as they nurture these little children in your love, in your care. We pray that Heavenly Father, give them your grace and your mercies. Speak to them so that they can speak to each and every child. May they conduct their lives as an exemplary to the children. May they see Christ in and through their lives, O Master Lord. Bless each and every teacher. Give them your knowledge and your wisdom and the power of Holy Spirit to lead every child into your kingdom. We especially pray for youth of this congregation. Bless each one of them. In their days of youth, help them to acknowledge you as their creator and always be thankful for you, for all that you do to them, O Master. Help them to conduct their lives according to your will, according to your plan and purpose that you have set for them. Help them to set an example for others in speech, in conduct, in love, in purity, O Master. We especially remember those who are seeking for jobs. We pray that Heavenly Father, give them the right job, right opportunity to utilize all their talents and skills. Give them a good source of income, O Master. Help them to lead their lives with dignity. Help them to always love you and glorify your name for who you are in their lives. We especially pray for the ones who are looking for alliances. You yourself bring them the right partners and unite them through marriage and bless through families, O Master Lord. At this moment, O Lord, we especially pray for women of this congregation. Bless each one of them. Grant them your wisdom and your grace. Give them extra portion of your strength when they serve each one of us in our families. As they partake in this church ministry, we pray that Heavenly Father, give them your grace and your mercies to carry on all the responsibilities with utter sincerity and utter care, O Master. Give them your grace and your mercies to love and serve humanity around them. We especially pray for men of this congregation. Bless each one of them as they venture out into various careers, professions and businesses. Bless all the work of their hands and establish it, O Master. As your word says, commit all your ways to the Lord and he will prosper. As they commit their ways and seek your guidance, prosper them. Give success in everything that they do, O Master. Help them to be the chief priests of their families and lead the family to your kingdom and to your presence, O Master Lord. Protect them and provide for all their needs. You be the source of life and source of everything that they possess, O Master. We especially pray for senior citizens of this congregation. Bless each one of them in their days of weakness and fragility, in the days of difficulty. We pray that Heavenly Father, you be near to them when they call you, O Master. Incline your ear to their prayers and answer them. You be their rock and fortress, and Lord, provide for all their needs. We pray that Heavenly Father, if anybody is suffering from any sickness, we seek your healing touch upon them. Stretch forth your healing hand upon them and heal them completely, O Lord. Restore them to good health. Help them to rejoice in your healing. We especially pray for the ones who are lonely, depressed, who are in need of your friendship. We pray that Heavenly Father, as the mother comforts, comfort them. You be their friend, O Master Lord, in their time of need. Protect them. Give them your word. Give them abundant life to each and every individual who is seeking your presence, O Master. At this moment, O Lord, we especially pray for our nation, India. Thank you for this land, its people. Thank you for the freedom that you have given to us to worship. Thank you for our leaders. Especially at this moment, we remember our President, Sri Ramnath Kovind, our Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi, all the members of the parliaments, Chief Minister of all the states, especially the Chief Minister of Karnataka State, all the members of legislative assemblies and legislative councils. Give them your knowledge and your wisdom. Help them to govern us with justice and peace. Help them to frame policies for the welfare of the poor, the needy, oppressed and marginalized communities of this society, O Master. We especially pray for our church, Methodist Church in India, its spiritual leader, our Bishop N.L. Karkare, our Bishop Amma Kamal Karkare, all the district superintendents, especially our district superintendent, Reverend Sebastian Ravi Kumar, all the pastors, deacons, evangelists, missionaries, and lay preachers. Help all of us to radiate Christ's love and service in and through our ministry. May our life tell story of God's grace and mercy to the people in and around us, O Master. Help us to rightly and duly administer all the sacraments for the spiritual nourishment of fellow believers, O Lord. At this moment, we especially thank you for the pastoral team at Koramangala Methodist Church. Thank you for your calling and anointing upon our senior pastor, Reverend Matthew George, our assistant pastors, Reverend Naveen Ezra Daniel, Reverend Martin Abhishek. Lord, as you have called us, as you have given us the responsibility of tending your sheep in this congregation, we pray that Heavenly Father, may your spirit strengthen us. May you use us as a mighty instrument to bring many lost souls to your kingdom, O Master. Help us to be sincere and faithful in all the tasks and responsibilities that you have entrusted to each one of us, O Master. At this moment, O Lord, we especially thank you for being our Lord and Master and leading us thus far. We especially pray for our institutions under Methodist Church in India, O Lord, in and through our institutions. Help us to always radiate Christ's love and characteristics, O Master Lord. Help us to do the good deeds for your glory. And Lord, may people see our good works and glorify your name, O Master. We thank you and we praise you. And we surrender our lives and all the prayer petitions into your mighty care, O Lord. Thank you for hearing our prayer. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray while we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our trespasses as we also forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever and ever. Amen. The scripture portion for this morning's meditation has been taken from 3 John verses 1 to 14. 3 John verses 1 to 14.
The scripture portion for today's meditation is taken from the third letter of John, verses 1 through 14. The elder to the beloved Gaius, whom I love in truth. Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you, and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. For I rejoiced greatly when the brothers came and testified to your truth. Yes, indeed, you are walking in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Beloved, it is a faithful thing you do in all your efforts for those brothers, strangers as they are, who testified to your love before the church. You will do well to send them on their journey in manner worthy of God. For they have gone out for the sake of the name, accepting nothing from the Gentiles. Therefore, we ought to support people like these, that we may be fellow workers for the truth. I have written something to the church, but Diotrephes, who likes to put himself first, does not acknowledge our authority. So if I come, I will bring up what he is doing, talking wicked nonsense against us. And not content with that, he refuses to welcome the brothers, and also stops those who want to and puts them out of the church. Beloved, do not imitate evil, but imitate good. Whoever does good is from God. Whoever does evil has not seen God. Demetrius has received a good testimony from everyone and from the truth itself. We also add our testimony, and you know that our testimony is true. I had much to write to you, but I would rather not write with pen and ink. I hope to see you soon, and we will talk face to face. May God bless this word in reading, understanding, and meditation. May God bless you.
As we prepare ourselves to listen to God's message, shall we all sing this hymn, Have Thine Own Way, Lord. Hymn number 154, Have Thine Own Way, Lord.
Till all shall see Christ. Christ only, always living in me.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for this morning. Thank you for this moment that you have given to us to come to your throne of grace, to listen to your voice, O Lord. As we, your people, have come, Lord, speak to us, for your servants are listening. May our ear hear your voice, may hearts follow your word, and apply it in our lives, O Master. Thank you for your grace and your mercies. As we meditate, we pray that Heavenly Father, fill us with thy Holy Spirit to understand the deeper meaning of your word, and in the light of your word, to reflect and get encouragement, inspiration to walk in the truth. We ask this in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear people of God, this morning, the topic for our meditation is walking in the truth. Walking in the truth. As we live in this 21st century, the notion that truth is objective, verifiable, fixed, universal, and defined truth is absolutely not required. Many people, they say, how can you claim that you know the absolute truth? The very idea itself is unclear to many people. And when we are living in this world, we see that truth comes in various shades. What is true to you need not necessarily be true to me. And everything what I believe is what matters to me are the statements which we hear from many of our fellow beings. And we see that there is opposition to truth, not only in today's context, even in the Old Testament times and even in generations, we see that there was always an opposition to truth. In today's context, to know the truth is the desire of many individuals living today. It is the desire of every common man to know the truth, to understand the truth, and to follow the truth. But we see truth is not an easily available commodity these days. It is a rare commodity, and truth is very expensive too. In this context, the Bible talks about walking in the truth. As we see when we read the scriptures, both the minor prophets and the minor epistles are neglected. As we see 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, the letters, it is very short letters what we see in New Testament. Many, they say, just to fill the pages, fill the gap, these letters have been written. But what we see is that these are like very small but has a powerful message to every individual, every Christian, and every church of today. It is like the Twitter of the New Testament, small in size, but powerful in its message. That's what 3 John chapter 1 verses 11 talks about, that we are called by Jesus Christ to move away from sin and to follow the truth. As Christians, we are called to move away from sin and to follow the truth, that is Jesus Christ, he himself. When John, the apostle, is writing these letters, he commends the people whom he is addressing. Verses 4, he says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. He is happy writing this letter and he says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in truth. The key word which he uses in all these three letters is truth. John takes delight in seeing Christians walking in truth. The truth which John refers is about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is about Jesus Christ, who He is and what He taught and what He did for us. And many of us, we know that Jesus Christ is Himself, indeed an incarnate of the truth who came to dwell amongst us. When John was writing this letter, the church was spread all across. It was throughout the Roman Empire. As it spread, it also faced few challenges and few persecutions in its growth. We see that the church faced trouble inside the church as well as outside the church. And we see outside the church, whatever challenges we face, it can be handled. When the challenges and problems arises within, it is very difficult and it is very sensitive to address. But John takes this bold step in addressing the issue which arises inside the church. And he writes this letter commending, warning, and appreciating certain people in this 3 John chapter 1. John warns in this letter against many false teachers. When you read 2 John, they have gone out into the world deceiving people, teaching wrong doctrines, teaching wrong things about Jesus Christ. John MacArthur, in his book, The Gospel According to Jesus, he writes, "Many of us have faulty theologies. It is as old as Bible itself." Yes, dear people of God, many of us are understanding the foundation which we have of our faith is many times faulty. Be it prosperity gospel, be it that many preachers, they preach, you will be blessed, 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 but they do not preach about the judgment. They do not preach about the repentance. They do not preach about coming back to God and repenting for our sins. Many of us have faulty theologies. And John in chapter 3, or 3 John chapter 1, he reminds us to know the difference and to understand what the real truth is. He says, truth is nothing but believing in Jesus Christ, walking in His teachings, and following Him. Many preachers during this time, they were preachers of the gospel, but they were not faithful to Jesus Christ. They were not faithful to Jesus Christ in the sense they did not preach about Jesus, who He is as a person, and what He is able to do, and what He did for the remission of our sins and for the redemption of the people. This message He wants to convey to the congregation by saying, walk in the truth, by saying, if you love each other, it is like walking in the truth. It is like walking in the teachings of Jesus Christ. When we read 1 John chapter 1, verses 6 to 10, it says, if we claim to have fellowship with Him, yet in the darkness we lie and do not live by truth. If we claim to have fellowship with Him, yet when we do not walk in the truth, we walk in the darkness. I would like to read from verses 5, 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 to 10. This is the message we have heard from Him and declare to you, God is light, in Him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with Him, yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. Dear people of God, if we claim that we are in good fellowship with one another, yet if we walk in darkness, we are lying and we are not genuine or true disciples of Jesus Christ. Even when you read 2 John chapter 2, verses 3 to 10, this also talks about 2 John chapter 2, verses 3 to 10. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and from Jesus Christ the Father's Son will be with us in truth and love. It has given me great joy to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as the Father commanded us. And now, dear lady, I am not writing you a new command, but one we have had from the beginning. I ask that we love one another, and this is love, and that we walk in obedience to his commands, as you have heard from the beginning. His command is that you walk in love. In second letter of John, he writes that not only walking in truth, but also walking in love is very essential for us as Christians. And he's saying it is not a new commandment that I am giving it to you, but rather he says it is a commandment that which we have received from God the Father as well as Jesus Christ. He says, love one another, hate what is evil, walk in the light, walk in truth, and be children of God. If we call ourselves as children of God, it is an obligation for us to love one another, to hate evil, and to walk in the light, walk in the truth. Verse 7, it says, do not let anyone lead you astray. He is writing this letter to a lady and warning her that do not be led astray by the false teachings and false preachings. And further, he encourages them to love one another because love is the glue that holds all of us together in unity. Love is the one which holds us together as a glue. And further, he gives an example of Abel and Cain. And he addresses this issue by saying, do not be like Cain who murdered his own brother. Do not be like Cain, always accepting and enjoying the evil acts or the acts of darkness. He reminds that we Christians are called to be children of God, to be children of light, to be children of love and children of truth. Dear people of God, what are we today when we come together as a church? When people see our families, what are we? Are we the children of God walking in the truth? Do people recognize us as some unique people, followers of Jesus Christ, humble, truthful, and always loving, always caring for other beings? He expects all the Christians in his church to whom he is addressing. Many scholars, they say he is addressing to the congregation in the Asia Minor. He says that because there was some problem in the church close to Ephesus, he writes and commands and warns these people about their behavior and asks them to walk in a way which is worthy of their calling as God's children. Dear people of God, he is not condemning us, he is not criticizing us, but he is asking us to mend our ways. God's love is given to us unconditionally. God's love is an emptying love. Kenosis, self-emptying love he has given. He has given everything to us. And same love is expected out of us. Be it our family members, be it our colleagues, be it our society, unconditional love, self-emptying love is what is expected out of us. But in today's context, we see self-centered, selfish love. Give and take love. Love is not given unconditionally. It is conditional today. But as God's children, John is asking us to walk in love, walk in truth. As Jesus was, he himself was truth. As disciples, as children of God, we have to reflect his characteristics. We have to reflect his values in and through our walk. When we say that walk, John uses this particular word walk not to mention walking in literal sense, but to conduct our life in a manner which is pleasing to God, in a manner which reflects Christ and God in and through us. C.S. Lewis, a great Christian thinker, writes in his book, Mere Christianity, about the basics and essentials of Christian belief. Among them, he writes, love is the foremost and very essential virtue or characteristics that Christians have to possess. Love should be the basic characteristic that a Christian should possess. he writes further and he says, how great is the love of the Father that he has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. Love, we love each other not because that we are gracious and we are something great, but rather we have to love because we have received that love, the truth from God the Father, and it is our responsibility to further it, to give it to the people in and around us. As John writes, these three epistles, he writes in relation to the opposite words. He says, God is light, those who walk in light. He uses this contrast, light versus darkness. And those who walk in light are children of God. Those who walk in darkness are the children of evil or children of Satan. Secondly, he uses this word, truth versus falsehood. He warns people about the false preachers and encourages them to follow the true teachings and true preachings of Jesus Christ. Thirdly, he uses life versus death. Those who walk in light, those who walk in truth, those who walk in love will always embrace life, whereas those who walk in darkness, falsehood, they will attain death. John's question to this congregation is, if God has lavished his love on us, we, being his children, have to act like one of God's children. If God has lavished his love on us, we being his children, why don't we act like one of God's children? As many of us have heard, whenever they see the children of a particular man who is of good virtue, who is of good standards, if their children also behave well, they say that exactly like his father, exactly like his mother, exactly like his grandfather, this child also behaves. Don't we expect the same thing with our children? That if we are good, we expect our children also to be good. Parents always want to emulate their behavior from their children. If we do not emulate, if we do not reflect the good character of our parents, many a times we are considered as children of evil. John says, walk in truth. If you know Christ, who said in John chapter 14, verse 17, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you know Christ, definitely you will put on his virtue and you will reflect his nature, his characteristics in and through your lives. On Sermon Mount, Jesus also preached that how, as a Christian, we have to conduct ourselves, how we have to behave in our earthly journey. A person who loves God should always act like God's children. It challenges us to avoid the counterfeit Christianity. Many a times we are artificial. Many a times we are fake in our behavior. But what John encourages the church members in this Asia is that a genuine Christian has to walk in truth and in love. A genuine Christian will always have to walk with integrity, humility, and generosity of life in response to God's love and grace. Dear people of God, that's what he brings, three examples. He addresses three people in this letter about their behavior in this church, which is encouraging, which is discouraging for the congregation which he is addressing. As he writes in verses 2, he greets his friend. He says, dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you. Even as your soul is getting along well, It gave me great joy to have some brothers come and tell about your faithfulness to the truth and how you continue to walk in the truth. Praying for the restored health, John prays for good spiritual health of his friend, whom he calls to my dear friend Gaius, whom I love in truth. Dear people of God, he addresses that through our word, through our actions, we have to be genuine, we have to be truthful. And he addresses this issue of spiritual health. What we understand from this verses is that though Gaius was physically weak, physically not well, spiritually he was wealthy. He was healthy. He had everything because he followed the statutes, the commandments of God. He honored God in and through his life. Verses 3 to 4, when we read a good testimony about this person, Gaius. He was recognized as a man who obeyed the word of God and one who walked in the truth. It mentions, dear friend, you are faithful in what you are doing for the brothers, even though they are strangers to you. The first quality of Gaius is that he was faithful to the word of God. He practiced whatever he read through the word of God. His spiritual well-being is appreciated, and John prays for his spiritual health. Secondly, he commends his good quality of hospitality. As many people came and reported about Gaius, he says and he recognizes that because he walked in the truth, because he obeyed the word of God, Gaius is able to practice this act of hospitality. It is Gaius' entire life that he was wrapped with this truth. If you love Christ, if you know this truth, you will reflect Christ's virtue in and through your lives. It is revealed to him through the word of God. John chapter 17, verses 17. Unless God reveals his truth to us, we cannot know the truth. The Holy Spirit is also truth. 1 John chapter 5, 6 talks about the Holy Spirit teaches us the truth. The Spirit of God uses the Word of God to reveal the Son of God to us and then enable us to obey the will of God and walk in truth. Thirdly, we see that not only he was a good person, but also he was involved in the ministry. Verses 5 to 8 talks about this and addresses that we have to therefore to show hospitality to such men so that we may work together for the truth. He is encouraging and he is commending his hospitality in nature, and he says we will work together for the truth, that is to proclaim the gospel. Many commentators, they say that Gaius, he helped financially to all the missionaries. He opened his house for the strangers, for the people who were on the mission journey. It takes faith and love to accept God's servants and messengers. James 2, verses 14 to 16, it says, faith must be proved by our works. Faith without works is nothing. Our works must be expressed by our deeds, not just our words, but in our action. What was the motivation for Gaius in this chapter? We see that he learned through the word of God that if you speak the truth, if you walk in the truth, if you walk in love, it honors God. Secondly, he learned that through this, it brings witness to the people who are lost, who are living in sinful nature, who are living in darkness. As God's servants, they deserve support. As Genesis chapter 14, verses 21 to 24, we see The king of Sodom approaches Abraham and grants gift. But Abraham denies it. He rejects this gift. Because the Bible says that do not accept the gifts from the unbelievers. And it is expected as missionaries and servants of God to receive gifts from the believers. Thirdly, what motivated Gaius to walk in truth is that he always obeyed to God. Obedience helped him to practice hospitality, to show kindness, to show mercy to the people who are in need. And verses 13 to 14, when we read, he gives benediction to this congregation by saying, "Peace be upon you. I have much to write to you, but I do not want to do so with pen and ink. I hope to see you soon, and we will talk face to face. Peace to you. The friends here send their greetings. Greet the friends there by peace." George Morrison, he writes, "Peace is the possession of adequate resources. The believer can enjoy the peace of God because he has adequate resources in Jesus Christ." If we believe, if we depend and rely on Jesus Christ for love, for peace, we will be given that peace and that love. How important for Christians it is to walk in truth and in love. When God's people love Jesus, we have to love one another. When we love one another, God dwells amongst us. The Spirit works in us, and He encourages us to build the church unitedly. The Spirit works in us and gives us the same Spirit, one accord, unity. When we come together in one accord and pray, our prayers will be answered. The church may appear to us outwardly that it is successful, but if there is no truth, if there is no place for work of the Holy Spirit in us, inwardly we will lack everything. Inwardly we lack the true unity of the Spirit that makes us to be a healthy fellowship. Working together in love alone will help us to build the church. That's what he addresses this congregation, and he encourages them to be truthful and to work together in love for the glory of God. As God's people, as we are meditating upon building the church throughout this year, it is my encouragement to each one of us that we, as God's children, let us walk in truth, let us walk in love, let us project our lives, which is a testimony to many people around us. Secondly, we see that verses 9 to 10, he talks about another person, Diotrephes, who was also a believer, who was in the church, but he is addressed as dictator. Verses 9, "I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to be first, will have nothing to do with us. So if I come, I will call attention to what he is doing, gossiping maliciously about us." Not satisfied with that, he refuses to welcome the brothers. He also stops those who want to do so and puts them out of the church. Here is a second character, Diotrephes, who behaves as a dictator, being bossy, being a person who wants to have upper hand always. He is warning Diotrephes about his behavior in the church, which is an obstacle, which is a stumbling block to be united and to be in the fellowship. And he says that what he is doing is gossiping maliciously about us, not satisfied about gossiping maliciously, but also stopping the messengers who are coming. It is told, many commentators, they say, he stopped the persons who were sent by John, the gospel, to the church. His attitude is, he wants to be the greatest among all the fellow beings. As we see in Matthew chapter 18 verses 1, disciples had this discussion with Jesus about who is the greatest in the kingdom. Disciples argued with Jesus, but Jesus gave a simple answer: those who become like children, innocent and humble, those who become like servant, they will not enter the kingdom of God. Today, many of us who are in ministry, instead of holding the towel and washing the feet of the people and the church members, we hold expensive cell phones in our hands and walk around. Instead of having a kind heart, we have selfish ambitions. Instead of love for the lost souls, we have self-vested interest in this. He is warning people who have this kind of behavior in the church to come away, to move away from this, to move away from the darkness and to walk in the light. And third allegations or third thing which Diotrephes did was, whoever came or whoever disagreed with him, he put those people outside the church, even though he did not have authority to do that. But the dictator attitude, he put some church members outside the church. John says it is the work of Satan, and he warns people not to be like Diotrephes the dictator. Thirdly, third character he mentions in verses 12 is that Demetrius. He is a well spoken of by everyone and even by the truth itself. We also speak well of him, and you know that our testimony is true. He is talking about Demetrius, the exemplar. He sets an example. When we read what exemplar means, it is an ideal. It's a model, an example worthy to be imitated. John warned the leaders not to imitate Diotrephes. If you want to imitate anyone, then follow Demetrius. The question you might ask, should we follow human beings as our role models? Should we follow any individual as an example, as our ideal? But Bible also says, Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verses 1, he says, be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Hebrew chapter 10 verses 24 talks about, by the good example, we can consider one another to provoke into love and to do good works. Dear people of God, as God's children, it is a calling to each one of us to walk in truth. We as congregation need to be burdened to encourage others to walk in truth. We need to pray for one another, encourage one another to walk in truth and in love. When we do this, we will reflect God's image in and through us, God's characteristics in and through us. We will be united, and we will build the church for His glory. As we come to the Lord's table, let us acknowledge God's blessing. If we have committed any sin against Him, let us ask God's forgiveness. Let us ask God to help us to walk in truth and in love for His glory and to build His church for the glory of God and for the benefit of human beings. Let us pray. Gracious our loving Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for your word that has come afresh to us. Lord, thank you for the blessing of reading your word and meditating upon it. Lord, help us to trust in you and to walk in it. Many a times we have put masks on ourselves. Many a times we have behaved untruthful in many circumstances and situations. Lord, as you are the truth, as your children, help us also to reflect through a word, deed, and action the true virtue. Help us to always be truthful in our conduct. Help us to genuinely strive towards building your kingdom for your glory. Thank you for hearing our prayer. Bless our families. Lord, we surrender each one of us into your mighty care. As Christians, as children of God, help us to genuinely love our family members. Help us always to reflect your love in our families too. To that end, we surrender our lives and we ask this in the mighty name of Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us invoke God's blessings upon the people who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries during this week. Those who are celebrating their birthdays are 9th June, M.L. Oscar, 11th Ashrit, 13th Kingsley, 14th Samuel Dimpu. Those who are celebrating the wedding anniversaries are Mr. and Mrs. John Benjamin, Mr. and Mrs. Matthew Cherian, Mr. and Mrs. Viravalli Kumar. Let us surrender their lives into God's hand and let us invoke God's blessings upon them. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for this morning. Thank you for the gift of life that you have given to your beloved people. Yes, O Lord, at this moment we acknowledge that you are our Creator. You formed us in our mother's womb and you brought us to this world. Thank you for creating us wonderfully and beautifully and setting a plan and purpose for our lives even before we were formed. Thank you for your grace and your mercies that has sustained us thus far. We especially remember those celebrating birthdays during this week. We pray and surrender their lives into your mighty care, O Lord. As they step into this new year, may they draw closer to you. May they experience your love, your grace, your mercies, and your peace in their lives, O Master. In everything that they do, help them to see success and prosperity and be grateful to you, O Lord. Thank you for all that you have done in their lives in the past years. Thank you for being faithful, God, providing for all their needs, protecting them from all the dangers, and Lord, sustaining them thus far. Thank you for your grace and your mercies. At this moment, as a church, we rejoice along with them and celebrate their life because you have created them and you have given them in our fellowship. We especially pray for the ones who are celebrating their wedding anniversaries. We commit these couples into your mighty care. Thank you for being a faithful God in their marital covenant all through these years. And thank you for enabling them to see one more new year together, O Master. As they step into this new year, may your grace, peace, mercy be in their lives, O Master. Touch them and heal them. Give them your grace and your mercies to continue to be role models in this society. Be the third person in their marital covenant and bless them and bless their families, O Lord. We thank you and we praise you. Thank you for hearing our prayer. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. There are a few announcements for the week. Next week's service will be at 9:30 a.m. We have received guidelines to open our churches. We are glad that we could come together and worship God. We are still waiting for further guidelines from our district superintendent, after which it will be communicated to you through the service. But kindly be prepared to worship God in His holy sanctuary and be blessed. 14th Sunday evening, 7 p.m. we'll have men's fellowship through Zoom. Kindly, all the men of the congregation, make note of this. Participate and be blessed. From today onwards, 7th June, online Sunday school classes begin. Kindly, parents and children, make note of this and participate. Parents, help your children to grow in the Lord. God bless you all. In response to the message that we have heard, and as we prepare ourselves to partake in this Holy Communion, let us all rise and sing, "Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus." As we sing this hymn, let us also offer our offerings. Offerings can be offered in three ways. Scan the QR code on the screen, and you can mention in the description box SRMC, and you can offer your offerings. Secondly, you can go to our website srmcblr.org, mention SRMC, and then you can offer. Thirdly, those of us who are not tech savvy, kindly store all the offerings, and when the church opens on 14th, kindly bring your offerings to the presence of the Lord. Shall we all sing the same, "Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus"?
Love. order for the administration of the sacraments of the Lord's Supper, the Holy Communion. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God.
Let us humbly confess our sins by saying all together this confession. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word and deed against thy divine majesty. We do honestly repent and heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us. Most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all of them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn to thee, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. These are the comfortable words that Jesus speaks to his children. He says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the expiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby the offering of himself a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father. We most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his passion, death and resurrection, may be partakers of the divine nature through him, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. Amen. Shall we all join in this prayer together? We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather of the crumbs on thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to partake of this sacrament of thy Son Jesus Christ, that we may walk in newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Dear people of God, as I take the bread in my hand and also say these words, then you can also take the bread in your hand, and after saying that sentence of prayer, then you can have along with us. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for thee, preserve thy soul and body unto everlasting life. Take and eat in this in remembrance that Christ died for thee, and feed on him in thy heart by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. You can take the bread now. Now you can take the grape juice or water in your hands, in the cups. As I say this prayer, after the prayer you can have this as a symbol of Christ's blood. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for thee, preserve thy soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for thee, and be thankful. Now we can take the grape juice as a symbol of Christ's blood. Dear God, as we have participated in this online communion at this time, we uphold each one of us as we have participated in your table, partook your body and blood. Continue to bless each one of us, sanctify our lives, give us grace to be connected to you, and help us to be ever grateful unto you for what you have done on the Calvary's cross for our redemption, O Master. Lord, let your grace and abundant mercy be poured upon each one of us to bear much fruit unto you, reflect your life, spread the fragrance of your life, love through our lives, O Master. We thank you, we praise you. We commit once again, each one of us who have participated in this online communion, into your care. We give you all glory, honor, praise unto your name. Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As a reverence to God, please stand wherever you are and join in the closing prayer which is displayed on the screens. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thy humble servants desire fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and thy whole church may obtain forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and lively sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. Let us receive the benediction of God. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among us, and remain with us always. Amen.